Hello. I needed to do a monthly wrap up, but not feeling very well, and I'm in my cozy blanket. However, if I wait any longer, I have too many books I have read already, and the list is going to become exhaustive. So I'm going to start with the middle grade. And as I spoke in my TPR, the first one to start with would be a Joyce Williams series. There is a movie based on them called Rise of Guardians. The series consists of 5 books that follow different guardian, but also continue the story. So the first one is St. North, second one is Bunnyman, third is Tuviana, fourth is Sandman, and the fifth is Jack Frost. I would really love if someone did like a challenge, finish all of them and have a video and wrap up more about each of them. It didn't take me long, so it took me about a week to go through all of them. And that means I was rather engaged and it was very imaginative. So definitely worth a try. I felt a lot of different elements in there and it felt a little bit too many. However, there are a few discoveries, and the first thing that sort of melted my heart was that the place itself is called Town of Santa Clausen. Just makes me smile. Just seeing it for the first time made me smile. And the second thing was Sanderman Mansnoozy is Sandy's name, and that also just made me giggle. I love it. My favorite still probably would be Tufiana, because as I described, it was a touchy scene that I felt was touchy. It wasn't as touchy as maybe it sounds from my description. But also because looking through illustrations, the fairy is illustrated like a really looks like a badass. And I love strong female characters. Overall, there was not enough Jack Frost story, but also we find the human side of Pitch, which is also somewhat interesting. I was looking for something else going into it, but I think there are a few discoveries there as well. Next is The Last Shadow Warrior. I felt like everyone was talking about it quite a bit. It's about Abby, who is the last Viking warrior, and she's trying to save her dad. From the beginning, from the first third, I could feel that it's probably serious. And then I sort of gone on and read about the interview of the author, and he did mention he wishes for it to become serious. So the pacing does show, but definitely worth a try. I do need to talk about Believathon, because I did attend it recently. It was my first live sprint. So being unwell, I was watching a lot of reading sprints to sort of support myself and try to at least read or to keep being productive while being in bed. So I started with Gavin. Definitely visit his channel. So I started with his call Snuggly Sprints, and it was pre-recorded, not live, so I was just watching pre-recorded sprints. I never was involved in any other sprints before, and just so happened that Believathon is currently running, and it was live in a day that is kind of comfortable for me. So I joined in live, and I did ask them if what book to read, and I ended up reading Snow and Rose. Now, Believathon's supposed to be played with certain rules. It's a event created by Gavin to sort of read more middle grade, and it has certain rules to pick your books. I didn't jump into it from the beginning, so I didn't really play by the rules, I apologize. However, I think it's a good initiative to just keep reading middle grade. So I picked whatever was available on my shelf at the moment. So Snow and Rose, I finished it in one read. So that was good. That It's meant for lower grade, middle grade, I think, given illustrations and the font. It's beautiful, and the words that are written on here from New York Times are graceful, satisfying. And that's how it definitely felt. There was a lot of magical elements. Like, other books tend to use a lot of magical elements and they're not tied together all the time. And sometimes something jumps in and jumps out. While if you follow up to the end, every single detail was foreshadowed and meant to tie up. It's in the plot line, it's not, you know, the strongest story, let's say, but that bit that everything ties up neatly just, yeah, it's satisfying. I was expecting, given title and the story, that Snow and Rose, two sisters, will be a bit more separated. And even though I felt we were trying to do so and giving some juxtaposition, the line felt like we sort of still quite close together. One of the best things about this book is pacing. Even though it had a lot of different, almost different stories and elements in it, in between anything magical, it would be grounded with a sort of family story and daily activities. For example, celebrating a birthday. And it was very family grounded, and I found it cute and lovely, and the end is lovely, so definitely keep reading. The book I unpacked last time, this was a find for me. I actually picked it up because it was endorsed by Neil Gaiman, and I find that some books that are endorsed by Neil Gaiman really fit with my taste. And The Sister Who Ate Her Brothers, Another Gruesome Tales, definitely fit there. I'm currently writing few middle grades, and one of them is a horror one, and it's sort of fragmented in stories, so I found this being very close to what I wanted to achieve, however I want to do a continuous story, so, well, you cannot have everything. It's written by Jen Campbell. She has an Instagram, and she also has a YouTube channel where she talks about other books, which mostly are adult books rather than children, but I definitely suggest you check it out. I'll put it in the description. It consists of fairy tales. The Sister Who Ate Her Brothers is actually about a shape-shifting fox, and it's based on Korean folktale, or let's say myth. And there are different origins and different countries, so every time you read a tale, you can actually look what is the origin, so it gives you more of sort of background. It's a very short story, so don't want to spoil a lot about it, but it's really befitting almost the ghost story vibe. It can be told in one breath, let's say. Other thing that to mention is the illustrations. It's really, really well-coordinated book. So the beginning, right, this book belongs to page, is like a gravestone, and just a lovely touch to it. And it's illustrated by Adam D'Souza, and I think that's someone else worth keeping on the radar. Other things, in every single page and chapter, you have corners illustrated with different objects, and they usually fit the story. The author itself is gonna get on my radar, and she have written a short story collection as well, and I'm gonna check it out at some time. So going into adult, I was mostly looking into new adult section. I'm currently writing or editing, let's say, a romance that is about witchcraft and patisserie. So it's kind of a paranormal romance, and all the paranormal romances seem to lie in this new adult category. I don't really believe in new adult, and I don't know if I'm already self-sabotaging, because from what I'm reading, it doesn't really, my story doesn't fit this sort of genre or category, and it feels more adult rather than paranormal romance. So, self-sabotaging. The X-Hex and Fix It Witches, first one. I was looking at the second one because it was about the boss, and I found like I might like it better. Both of them, both of Fix-It Witches and the X-Hex have a 50s vibe, and I don't know what it is about this witchcraft and 50s vibe, but this kind of reminded me of Bewitched with all the stars, as almost like it is in the opening, and the witch on the broom on the corner. And then Fix-It Witches had this Hepburn-like, Audrey Hepburn-like dress. What I find about this paranormal romance genre, it didn't land very well with me, but I think there's going to be readers who might like it, just because it gets a bit too sexual at the end, and I'm not really looking for it. And even this line in the X-Hex, which literally says, like, let's stop talking about sex and break this curse, and I'm like, exactly my point. And I really want to more read about well-done curse dynamics rather than relationship itself. Didn't quite enjoy it, but, you know, I'm researching the genre to make sure I'm not doing mistakes. Again, it's not a big book in a sense of, you know, reading, but I feel like this really fits Christmas for some reason. It has this sort of, for me, it's really wintry cover. It's called The Lost Spells. And under the dust jacket, I don't think it can be visible, but there are imprints of like a moth or a butterfly, which is inside pages. And it's all full of illustrations in the lovely watercolor style. It's more of a poetry book, so you have a lot of illustrations and poetry lines. It's one of my keeper books just because of the sort of vibes it's giving. It's a source of inspiration, right? And I feel like I didn't hear enough people to ever talk about this book or show it, so wanted to raise awareness. Then speaking about my TBR for December, obviously I read witchcraft romance and I thought maybe I'm looking at the wrong angle and I should read some baking romance. So I picked the coincidence of coconut cake. And so far it's not too bad, just sort of started. It's about a chef and a critic, and critic leaves bad review for a chef, and there's some sort of romantic subplot in between them. So we're gonna look at that. And the other one that I'm looking forward is Nevermore, because I feel like right in middle grade, I probably need to read this. Everyone's talking about it. I don't think I need to blurb it. It's Nevermore, The Trials of Morgan Crow, and Morgan Crow is a girl who is destined to die on her 13th birthday. She's cursed to die on her 13th birthday, and then she gets whisked away into a magical world. Definitely gonna read it, and I know there's a second book that everyone's on now. I managed very well in the sense that I definitely have no blank days that I haven't written on or read, which I had about 5 to 6 blank days in October. In terms of the words that I progressed with my word counts, that I progressed with my projects, I've done about 8,000 words, and for me it's a very good number. I'm not specifically ever counting numbers, I just know like the size of each project I want to reach, and most of this growth is done on my adventure middle grade. I actually thought out new scenes and sort of B-plot to add onto it. As well, I have a few scenes I want to add into my romance, which is more like very late edit for myself. I'm not really working much through my horror middle grade. Fantasy project is really for printing out and putting in a shelf. I'm not working on it actively anymore. The only thing I've done for it is I recently received some professional edit from the first few chapters. I did do a video on it, but I scrapped it because I don't really know what I'm doing and I don't think I should be wasting anyone's time on blabbering about my experience. There are a few things that I felt like I over-edited and I'm not necessarily liking, both from my editing, like tagging every dialogue line, or from my mentorship feedback. And one thing to take away is that chapter that I edited more in the past, like adding details and growing, had more colored pages than a chapter that I didn't change as much. So I think in the end, we sometimes self-sabotage. For the next month is trying to grow my scenes a little bit and the bringing the ideas for B plot and everything that I thought of already. I just need to sit down and write it. In my own process, I often get in this cursed circle, which I also wanted to talk about, where I start from the first chapter, end up in the fifth chapter on one day, next day I start from the first chapter, end up on the fifth chapter, and never go beyond that line, because every day I feel like I want to start from the beginning. And that's how also over-editing in certain places. As I say, I don't feel very well, so I speak a lot of nonsense. Please do recommend any books I might like, or any ideas on what to try next.